As Sylvain said, I'm from Grenoble, and my main research interest is in expressive rendering, so not directly linked with fabrication. But what I will present today is the work of Hugo Loi, who did his PhD thesis with me. Incredibly, we received the result of the acceptation of this paper to talk after three major revisions this night. So I'm kind of very happy to say that this paper will soon be on the web. Hugo has been supervised by Romain Vergne, who is also in Grenoble, and Thomas Hurtut, who is in Montreal, and by myself. So the problem we target in this project is to find a programmable approach to synthesize element textures. And all along my project, I'm trying to find ways to allow users to produce, to create some stuff. And by creation, I mean to came up with original things or to put their own intent in the creation and to obtain the result they have in mind. And there are several ways to do that. There is always a compromise to find between giving the user a lot of freedom or helping him with the computer, but at the cost of maybe some more automatic approaches where he may have less control. And in this project, it was the first time I was trying to work with a programmable approach. This is certainly not for any artist, because not all artists are able to write some scripts, but actually more and more digital artists are able to write some scripts because they have to do that in modelers and so on. So the objects we are trying to synthesize are element textures, texture made of geometric elements distributed on the plane. And the texture part is that wherever you look in the texture, you have something that is visually similar. These textures are usually represented in vector graphics, which make them very useful for, as they are easily editable, they are independent from the resolution and can be used for typically laser cutting or things like that in the context of fabrication. You can find a lot of them in illustration. This is a standard way to produce black and white illustration since years. You can also find them in cartography, but also to symbolize some materials in architecture plans or all this kind of stuff. And also, you can also find this kind of texture as a layout to build some more complex texture, like in this floor here. So this is a short table of contents of my talk, and it's quite standard. So first, what is the problem? Texturing is a hard task, and here are all the people who are acknowledged for texturing, for example, in Avatar. So it needs a lot of work to design, and this is the reason why we think a computer could be helpful for that. Since years, procedural texture in raster graphics have been well developed, and especially algorithmics have this substance software that is more and more used in by a lot of companies for movie making. So in the algorithms, in the substance software, this is already a kind of programmable approach in the sense that the user explains how treat the texture step after step to come up with the texture it has in mind. But they do not target element texture, either vector texture in substance. And if you can come up with a nice vector texture, you can use them similarly as in movie making to put them on 3D object or do whatever you want with this kind of texture. So when someone wants to draw an element texture, usually what he does, he draws some elements to be distributed on the plane. Then he arranges them on the plane with certain rule. And then he can stylize the resulting elements. And in this talk, we really focus on the arrangement part of this process. there are some, a lot of work to on the drawing of elements or finding an element in between two elements or this type. And that, there is also a lot of previous work on stylization. So really target on how to let someone choose the arrangements he wants for his station. And so the question is, what do we need to come up with something we are happy with? So there are the four properties we think are necessary for such a project. The result has to be predictable, as always in computer graphics, I think. The expressiveness of the method has to be as wide as possible, meaning that you would like to create all this kind of texture. We found them on the web just as examples. It has to be usable, meaning that a user should be able to do what he wants to do with the techniques and without a learning curve too high, and so on. And it has to be extensible, meaning that if in the soft or the product you are not able to do precisely what you want, it should be easy to extend it, to add some new algorithm or something else to let you do really what you want to do. And there is another property that we would like to satisfy specifically for texture, is the stationarity, meaning that in two windows on the texture, you should have the same, let's say, visual properties, or the texture has to be homogeneous. And so when you are dealing with programmable approaches, the question is, what kind of operators, what kind of concept you have to give to the user to let him do what he wants to do. And this is really the hard part and what took, took us the most time on this project. So before going into what we finally proposed, a short previous work. So in standard software and on some previous work to produce element texture, people can use predefined layouts. They can be either a kind of regular or a random layout. But in that case, the user is constrained to stay in the context of the predefined layout. Most popular are exemplar-based approaches, similar to what we find in raster texture synthesis. You have a small exemplar that is analyzed, and then, based on this analysis, you resynthesize a full texture. The problem with these approaches is that they are not always able to capture during the analysis some specific properties of the exemplar. And so somehow they are restricted by the analysis algorithm. So there are two examples where this is more or less up for each of these previous methods to capture the organization of the crosses and so on. And more than that, there has been a study showing that if you give an exemplar to an artist, to several artists, they won't come up with the same result. So even a human does not interpret similarly the exemplar that you give to him. So it probably means that my example approaches will always fail on some exemplar for a given user, from the point of view of a given user. And finally, when in the exemplar you have some higher level structures that appear, like clusters or alignments, most of previous methods are not able to reproduce that way. Because during the analysis, they do not search precisely for higher level structure in the example. And finally, there has been a lot of work also on procedural modeling, mostly based on grammar, shape grammars. So these approaches are quite close to programmable approaches, because you also, in that case, have to devise some rules with the grammar. And they are very good to patterns that are growing, but not as good for a stationary pattern all over the plane. And writing some grammar rules is not always very easy for the users. So our idea is to really go to a programmable approach where the user will write a script directly to describe his texture. So to choose the correct concept, the correct operator, the correct word that we will give to the user as his programming language, we have tried to describe what it can be the process of a user trying to say, okay, this texture is the algorithm that corresponds to this texture is this one. So for that, we have to give to the user something that helps him to divide the construction process of his texture and to express it with a very simple API with a simple language. So if you look at such a texture, normally, but you are able to think, okay, this is a texture made of some blobs, and in each blobs there is another pattern drawn in each block. So this texture probably is made with two stages. For the blobs, these are blobs distributed in the plane, and these blobs are distributed randomly in the plane. Maybe you can think, okay, they have all the same distance in between them, so it's more like a uniform distribution than a purely random distribution. For this one, you can say, okay, I can tell that this small curve element has been distributed inside the blob, and the repetition of all these curves follow a precise pattern that is regular and where there are connections in between each of these curves. And so you come up with two kinds of patterns if you look at it globally, some irregular patterns and some regular patterns, where you distribute elements and they want to control some connection in between them. And this is what helps us to come up with our proposition of a specific language. So the idea we propose is to start building a texture by telling, okay, this is regular or irregular, and we control that by letting the user create first a partition of the plane. This partition ensures the stationarity because this is the same all over the image, and the user can control the size of the cells, the number of the cells, if it's uniform or random or whatever. And once he has decided the starting partition, then we use some mapping operator where the user can say, okay, in each cell of this partition, I will distribute one given element, or on each edge of this partition, I will distribute this kind of elements to produce the final organization. And then once you have all these patterns, you can combine them to produce the final result. So like in this example, you say the grid pattern is mapped in each block. And these three categories of operators are the core of our design language, and nothing else is needed. So the API is really, really small to produce all the results. Just one word of what is behind, because we of course need to have a data structure to store all these things. So we use the planar map, we use SIGAL to implement that. And the good thing with planar maps is that it gives you all the incidence and connection intersection between all the curves in the plane. So it means that you can control explicitly, have access to this information, and this is stored internally as an instance graph. So this is a structure that is really powerful, but it has a cost. The computation time is often a bit long because each time you add an element in the planar map, you have to recompute all the intersection and so on. So just to give you a hint of what are the scripts user can write, so we have chosen to write some script in Python because it's an easy language to do that. So for this example, the first line, he described the grid partition as the starting point. So he gives the space between the lines for the two angles. So of course the grids can be squared, but it can also give some more weird angles. So this gives the first texture. And then he says, he defines a mapper saying that each face is rotated of P over 4, which gives the final result. And that's all. There's nothing I did in this script. So it's very easy to write for people who knows how to code. similarly, you can define a random partition, which is so here this is a uniform partition, basically. it's behind, and then you can define a mapper saying that okay, this blob I have drawn this blob element in Inkscape, typically in your case, in SVG. So I import this blob, and in each face, I put this blob randomly turned, and you will obtain this result when you apply your mapper to each face of the partition. another example where you map the curve on each edge of the grid. So here you have to be more explicit to tell the incidence, to say okay, the starting point of the curve has to be put on the starting point of the edge, and that's it. And this one is a bit more complex. It just shows that with a similar way of thinking, mappers, you can map a full arrangement in each face of a given partition. So here we start from what we had just before, and we define map arrangement, which is a mapper that would be applied to each face. And in it, we define a new partition, which is the grid, and so on. And we map this partition in each element of the texture. And so once the user has understood this principle, it gives really a lot of freedom to produce very complex textures. So here are some results showing a bit the variety of patterns we can end up with. So for example, on the left, we started with a grid map, long curve on each cell of the grid, and added some stripes in each cell, and mapping again a curve. On the right, these are circles map on a grid, and then we remove randomly some part of the circles, try to simulate a mosaic, a bit old mosaic. For people who are good at drawing, they can draw very nice elements to enrich the arrangement. So here, most of the aesthetic of this result comes from the elements that were drawn in Inkscape. And this pattern also corresponds to the paper wall groups. So we showed in the paper that we can produce arrangements following the paper wall groups. Other results based on random or irregular uniform partitions. Actually, in our experiments, we ended up to the fact that random irregular distribution, you can make lots of things with it, but it's kind of less expressive than regular partitions. You can also play with the combination between various distributions, and you can add some labels to edges or to the cells of the panel app, allowing you to produce this kind of funny CPU representation where the two partitions are combined, and you add these elements, a circle or a square, depending on if you are in contact between two edges or edges and a face, because you have all this information in your panel app. And finally, we have tried to reproduce example we started at the start, we found at the beginning, and we somehow ended up to be able to reproduce the arrangements. Of course, the stylization is not in our arrangements. Some examples of use of the texture made by Laurence Boissieu, who is working in the lab, and used to map on 3D objects. And I already shown that at the beginning. For the usability, it's not so easy to evaluate, of course, as always. So the first thing I can say is that you can really work by trying and error, because you can save all the steps of your texture construction to see if it's okay for you. So usually, at least the way all the authors are working with the tool are really that way. We make a first thing, we see if it's okay, and we refine progressively our texture. So here is an example of the various steps we did to end up with these kind of things. And we also did a user study to try to assess the usability of the method. So the idea was to give a target pattern to some users and ask them to reproduce these patterns in 10 minutes. So we asked that to people in the lab, so all people were knowing how to code. So they were not all knowing Python, but it's really easy to learn. We teach them all the basic concepts, like during 1 hour, and then we ask them to produce the patterns. So it gives you an idea of what they come up in 10 minutes for each pattern, which so for us it shows that they were able to devise the construction steps for the texture, and then they made choice for the parameters and in terms of distance between fields and so on. So it varies between each user. The most complained was the computational time, of course. So to finish, I will show you an application to cartography. We did that in the context of an ANR project with the French National Geographical Agency. The cartography is a very good example where you don't want people to draw this kind of texture by hand. And actually, they have a big problem at IGN, is that they don't know how to automate the rendering of rocks in topographic maps. So the top 25 map series you use to work in the mountains, the production is mostly automated, except for the mountain zones where they reuse some drawings, very old drawings, and there are no more cartographers that are able to do the drawing by hand, and it's too expensive for the agency to ask such a task for all the friends. So they really need to automate this stuff. And the mountains are changing, so 50-year-old drawings become to be a bit false now. So the challenge we tried to target is this very nice map. So this is a series of maps designed, drawn of the mountains at 10,000 scale. So this is more detailed than what you have in the top 25 series. So when you look at this map, you can see that there are several layers, and one of the layers is made of element texture, which is distributed on the plane, that helps to perceive a bit more clearly the relief, the height, and so on of the map. So if I show just the hatching layer, you will see that. So of course, the other layers also add some information for the guy who is looking at the map. What I was very surprised of is that the rules to draw these maps are not clearly identified. There are some basic rules, and then it seems that each cartograph was kind of interpreting what he was seeing to make the drawing. So it's not very easy to find an algorithm to produce this kind of stuff. So what we did is we really worked with the National Geographical Agency to iterate and try to come up with something that is meaningful for them. And this is a case where having a programmable approach is really nice because you just change some parameters, adapt your method to produce a new result and decomment, and you can do that step by step. So the data they gave us was a partition of the mountain, the information of a density corresponding to the lighting of the mountain, the orientation that should have the achieved in each face of the partition. The orientation is kind of a false perspective view of the achieved, and of course the height of the terrain. To do this project, so what I presented was a way to produce stationary arrangements, but of course to change the orientation or follow density, we have to a bit enrich our language to be able to follow some maps, so density maps. So those maps can be scalar fields or vector fields. And what we did, we added spatially varying arrangements in our language just by adding higher order functions that were taking some maps, maybe for example the density maps, and attach that to some different arrangements. So it doesn't change the philosophy of the programmation, it just adds some more complex function, and which is good with Python is that this is natively possible in the language to devise high order functions. So I won't go into the detail on the scripts, but now we can follow a given scalar or a vector field. And so, just to resume a bit the process, we iterate on each of these steps to end up with this representation. So we started to orient the edges in each mountain faces, and then they say, okay, no, the orientation is more like that, so they gave us a better orientation. Then they said, oh yes, the density should enhance the face separation, so the density should be higher when you are close to a valley or a ridge. That there is another hatching layer actually. If you look closely at the maps, the cartograph redraw some hatches along the ridges. So we added another layer, and how the density varies according to the height of the terrain. So it is here to show to enhance the relative height of the peaks in the mountain. So okay, we added something related to the height, and then we propose more complex arrangements. It's just to show you that the process we used to work with them. And I'm really convinced that the programmable approach was really good for this kind of iterations. So of course, the program were done by Hugo Loa. So probably in a more general context, there should be an expert programmer working with a cartograph or with any other application. Maybe you cannot put just the code in to anybody, and it probably needs someone who knows how to code. Yeah. And here is the final result when we recomposite our layer of hatches with the other layer. So it has been presented at the IGN, and it seems that they are happy with this first result. Of course, this is not the end of the story. They will have to refine and to be more precise with that. So maybe in several years we will have this kind of representation in IGN maps. I don't know. So okay, to finish the talk. After this project, I would really like to continue to work on programmable approaches, but it's not that easy. And at least there are some things that are missing in our approach. There are some textures or patterns that would be really easier to describe by some kind of declarative approach. It's not really the case with our operators. And for here, this example, for example, we would like to say, okay, you put these elements as long as you can until there is no more space to put them, which is not easily describable with our current approach. Also for the irregular arrangement, the cost is very high, and it's very easy to devise a specific approaches to produce very complex arrangements with a low cost, so we have to do something for that. For the regular arrangements, we have proposed to use some tiles in the planar map, because when an arrangement is regular, this is a repetition of a similar part of the planar map. So if you just keep the region in the planar map corresponding to the specific pattern you are dealing with, you just have to make the computation of the intersection on this specific small region, and then to just repeat it. And so this really, really increases the cost. But it doesn't work for irregular arrangements. And maybe, but I'm not sure that this makes sense for stylization, but we may also think of the stylization part. Would it make sense to make a programmable approach for stylization? I'm not sure. And that's all for me. Thank you.